Permaculture has been around for quite some time, actually. It has, I guess with its particular title, it's been around since maybe the 60s, I think. But native tribes and societies have been doing food forest systems since pretty much man has been around. But looking at it as an actual permaculture system was pretty much like the particular term was invented by Bill Mollison. And through him, he has been teaching people to do permaculture, and it has just been spreading since then, and has really started to pick up pace within the past 10 years or so, really. The design that we have for the gardens here at the Edgewood Retirement Community, first pretty much what we had to do was get the layout of how much area we had to work with. And so we had to get the scale of our project. And so this is all the square footage, or the linear footage of the garden. And then we started figuring out where the water would come in, where the sunlight came in, because here's north, south, west, east, and how the sunlight would come in and drape over the landscape, and how we would catch the water. And so then we just started designing, I started designing various different images so that it would look nice and would also catch water. And so this is ultimately what we came up with. We really wanted it to be meandering so that you could just walk through here, and no matter where you went, you never really had a dead end. You would just always be able to move around. And that we made sure that there was every path was wheelchair accessible, and they could access the garden. And then from there, pretty much we went through, started developing the phases of developing this site. So the first phase after the design and observation of the land was to go ahead and start putting in the swales, which also double as the paths that everyone are going to walk on. And so all the water comes in from the west, this corner of the property. And it comes down and flows through here. And comes out through like pretty much the parking lot and dumps out onto Veronica Street. And so we tried to have designs that would capture that water, and also that you could just meander and get to all the parts of the garden. And then also we had to move the planter boxes that they already had, which were positioned right around here. And we moved them over here so that people could access them more easily from this part of the garden. And they would, you know, look nice where they were. So this is all the mulch. And pretty much what we do is we dig out this area and about 8 inches deep, so that water, when it comes into a nice sponge-like material, which is the mulch, and gets held there. And then as it gets held and fills up that walkway, which stays nice and firm because it's made out of mulch, it gets captured and starts feeding the plants that we have planted right behind it, and that'll be another phase. And as it comes through, it gets captured and gets held throughout the whole system so that you don't have to water. It holds all of its water itself. And so the next phase that we were going to go into was to establish some of the fruit trees and some of the native plants and some of the cover crops. And so each one of these is a fruit guild. And all of this is the turf that was originally here. We're leaving that down to keep the soil nice and covered so that it doesn't dry out. Because when you let the soil get covered, when you leave the soil covered, it stays moist and keeps the microorganisms happy. When you remove it, when you leave soil pretty much naked, it bakes in the sun and it kills everything in the soil. And so you then pretty much have a desert once again. And so that's why we're leaving that down for now. It also looks nice. And so in these areas, we'll be putting in a fruit tree to get that established, because that's one of the things that takes the longest to get established. And a guild of herbs and plants around it that are companion plants that help that plant grow and that like each other. And that's like the first lesson for everyone, is to that tree guild. And we'll be putting in little hoogle hoops around them, which are pretty much a similar idea to how the swales work, is that it builds up a whole bunch of nutrients. It's like a lasagna of organic matter that you plant the plants down into, so they have a whole bunch of really yummy stuff to grow out of. And then back here, we were gonna have the native garden. So there'd be a lot of drought-hardy plants and nectary plants and larval plants for butterflies, so that there'd be a butterfly garden and bees would come in. So it would be help building ecosystem at the same time as having giving people a place that's nice and shaded that they won't be accessing quite as much to come in and enjoy. Because when a place is really far away from where most people interact, it doesn't get as much tending or cultivation, and so we don't want a bunch of food crops growing back there that aren't going to be tended, that will be forgotten and going to waste. So mostly this will be for the animals to enjoy and to bring in nectary, pollinators into our system. So the next phase of planting will be putting in a lot more of the annual and perennial plants, a lot more food. And it's all along those swales, as you can see, all in those areas where we're doing the water catchment. And we were going to start putting in some benches for people to sit down and enjoy. And then we were also going to put in a grape arbor right here, put in the framework and plant the grape guilds. So there'll be a series of different grape plants. And then also we'll have like hyssop and blackberry and passion vine all growing there because they are really good companion plants together.
How you doing?
Let's see, what else was there? And then finally, the last phase will be just completely filling in the entire area with plants and food product. And so, as you can see, ultimately, the whole plan fills in the whole area, and you are getting a great deal of coverage, where sometimes when you do row cropping, it may look like you're covering a lot of ground, but this system actually captures water and captures sunlight so that plants grow really well, and they don't get too much sunlight, because that frequently happens in row cropping. There's not enough shade, and so plants get photosaturated and start to get stressed and don't produce as well. And so this system allows them to get enough shade, but also enough sunlight, and get enough natural water so that they will grow, so you don't have to irrigate. And it also just fills in everything with food and companion plants and herbs, everything, so you don't have to have pesticides, because the herbs and everything support the whole plant system. And they're kind of mingled together so that, once again, if you have a monoculture, you have one area of disease, it can spread very easily. If you have one little plant right there that gets sick because it's not quite right for it, the other plants that are in other areas aren't going to be affected by it. And so there you have it, the whole system.
I'm Stephanie Hughes, and I'm working for Owl Fertile Earth. I'm actually doing an internship for Florida State College. I'm getting my environmental assessment degree. So I'm heading up the research and education. And we're doing some soil samples and things like that today. We want data. We want to know what the condition or the health of this ground was before we got here. A lot of Owl Fertile Earth's mission is to restore the actual fertility to the earth. So by doing the sample and getting raw data like that, we can go back later to those same spots and we can test and see how the soil has improved and things like that. Enco Laboratories actually donated $100 worth of lab time, and they're doing that test for us for free. So we'll be testing for 8 of those toxic metals, the most toxic. Permaculture can help help to remediate some of the things that you do not want in the soil. It's always good to naturally try to remove those things. I mean, of course, you can go to the EPA website and see how they do, you know, Superfund site remediation and stuff like that. But like I said, I don't expect us to be too toxic here, but I do expect after we do the permaculture, I do expect all of the nutrients to go up. I do expect all of the bad toxic things to go down ultimately. So we marked off this area right here, and then we measured 54 feet straight out, which is, this is due north. And we took a representative sample, which basically a representative sample is, we marked it off at 54 feet, and then continuing north every 3 feet in a zigzag pattern, we would take another sample about 6 inches under the soil. And then we mixed those 7 together to make a homogeneous mixture. And by doing that, we can get a good representative sample of that particular area. After we got those samples, we went 54 feet west and did the same thing heading south. We did 7 more samples in a zigzag pattern, and once again mixed them in a homogeneous mixture and to get a good representative sample of the area. And we will be sending off 2 of the samples for the tests I'll be doing myself. And then, like I said, Enco Labs will be doing the metals for us. So we'll have a good scientific overview of the actual health of the land.
I am John Jessup. Dennis Decker and I started this this ball rolling, and it's just bubbling up all around us. We're our Fertile Earth Incorporated. We are a fledgling nonprofit. I'm still waiting for the 501c3 to come through. We are putting together a network of farms, trying to bring good, wholesome food right here, right where we live, getting people involved in what they eat, gaining awareness in what we eat, trying to eliminate some of the travel time and the mysteries about where our food comes from, bringing this food is medicine message that so many people get, so many people don't, and don't know. It seems that we all understand this at some level. Awareness is huge. Just right in your face, right down the block, right in your neighborhood, right in your yard. We control the annuals and the food and the trees that are growing there. Instead of it just going fallow, we control and plant and produce food for the residents surrounding each and every farm slash garden, park, however you want to phrase that. Homeowners can put a little permaculture section of their yard in a very short period of time and just sit back and watch it flourish.
We have over 160 varieties of plants growing across the street. As you can see, it looks like a small jungle, but everything in there is edible or medicinal or useful. And we have different plants that support some of our fruit trees. All the plants work in concert with each other. What this is called is permaculture, and permaculture is a design science in which we look at how human beings relate to their environment. And this is how we relate to our environment. We plant our food and our medicine in our front yard, as opposed to having a lawn that just uses resources. This actually creates soil, and over time it gets better and easier to maintain. And it's a very pleasant place to hang out. There's a lot of wildlife and more wildlife showing up every day. We have new birds showing up. It's just a plethora for the wildlife, and it actually holds water in the landscape. Everything's thickly mulched. There's no bare soil, so every drop of rain that falls out of the sky gets stored in the soil. So we don't really have to get out there and water our plants too much.
Feed us right where we live. No train rides, no trucks, no airplanes. We don't need that sort of thing. We can grow right here. We live in North Florida. Beautiful climate, a difficult, tough climate on many levels. And challenging, it's always challenging, but we love that. We all love to toil. We need it, and we need the challenge. We just don't find anyone that dislikes what we're doing. Everybody loves what we're doing. This is on the tip of our society's tongue, speaking about it, doing it. So we tell people what we're doing, and they immediately want to help. Here are 30, 40 people out here that are testament to that. Many others could come. We put a cap because there's a lot of bodies in a short space. So, and we know what the workload is. So we only invited 30 or 40. Everyone is invited. Eventually, we have lots of work to do. So we're all learning this stuff. And this, for many people out here, is a groundbreaking, literally in their minds, into permaculture and into sustainable food production. You know, it's a beautiful thing. It is really a win-win.
Hey, my name is Jesse. I'm here to help out with the permaculture project we're doing out here today and get my hands dirty, contribute to the community and the movement that's going on. Hopefully we'll be seeing this grow nationwide, worldwide, and be a huge impact to the globe as we try to make a sustainable future for ourselves and for the future generations. Well, this is sheet mulching. We use this in permaculture to kind of basically start a new soil layer from where there was a ground cover like grass, or maybe even a open field with weeds and stuff like that. They kind of don't want to have those in there in this particular philosophy. So you basically put a bunch of cardboard down over the top of the grass or whatever you're covering, and you're going to we're covering that with wood chips that are from basically waste from tree companies. And basically the cardboard is going to break down over time, absorb moisture, and it will attract different types of life forms, worms preferably, that are going to eat it up and leave their casings to really enrich the soil and build the life, biological life on many levels there. As well as doing that, the wood will capture a lot of water. So every time it rains, the wood will soak it in and basically prevent it from evaporating off. And that will allow whatever we decide to plant in the future, a source of water that we won't have to continually add water to it. So basically, it's a way to start building soil from the top down. Some people like to add mushroom spores to it that will decay the wood faster. So they'll put the mushroom spores, they'll spread all over the wood and they'll help decompose and turn to soil. I've also seen where people add a material called rock dust, which has a lot of minerals and stuff, and that adds to the nutrient value of it. So that way when they plant in it, you know, whatever you're growing, if you're going to eat it, you get more nutritional value yourself from that food. So there's many different things you can do. I mean, as a starting process, it's just to get the soil started, to get a reservoir of water for whatever you're going to plant in the future, and then you could kind of use different design schemes, you know, from there. So it's really kind of up to what you'd like to do with it. But I wouldn't recommend using any fertilizers or anything like that. You really don't need those things. This is something that you can rely on, completely organic system, low irrigation, you know, really high efficiency.
It's been really exciting to be able to go in and reestablish ecosystems and feed people at the same time, empower people, get them outside, get them healthy food, healing food, medicines, all of that, and at the same time making beautiful designs with nature.
Permaculture is awesome. It's a revolutionary idea. It doesn't require guns. It doesn't require violence. We can get together. We could share this with the community. We can grow our own food, be self-sustainable, you know, reduce our dependence on money, on fossil fuels, on irrigation, a lot of things that as a society we're seeing become more and more scarce, but in reality, in nature, they're all there. We've done a really poor job of capturing that energy that nature has produced and using it in the most productive methods. So permaculture is a very efficient system, very efficient ideology that covers all your bases, living, everything. It's very, very holistic. So if you're interested in permaculture, if you're interested in, you know, making change in the world in a way that's sustainable and just personable and community driven, then this is a good philosophy to follow.